I'm Deirdre Fitzpatrick. How long could you hold on for your dream? For Bill May, the answer is 35 years. That is how long Bill has dreamed of competing in artistic swimming at the Olympics. Problem was, the Olympics had a no boys allowed rule at the Games in artistic swimming. So Bill went on a nearly 20-year career with Cirque du Soleil. In 2022, the IOC changed the rules to allow for mixed gender teams and up to two guys on each team starting in Paris. So now, at age 45, Bill May is a pioneer in artistic swimming and very close to his Olympic dream. First, I'll talk with Bill. Then I'll talk with the head coach, Andrea Fuentes. Andrea has to cut the current team from 12 to 8 for Paris. Is she committed to a mixed gender team? On this Dying to Ask the Road to Paris, how Bill has stayed in Olympic shape mentally and physically with team members who are half his age. Why representation and inclusivity matter in sports like artistic swimming. Take Dying to Ask on the go by downloading us on Apple or Spotify, or you can watch the conversation right here. So, Bill, we have a mutual friend, Lauren McFall.
Awesome.
2004 bronze medalist.
Yes.
And when I had first heard about this concept of mixed team and being able to have a man on the team, I sent Lauren a note like, what is up with this? She said, not only is it awesome, he's one of my best friends.
Oh, yes. Lauren is one of my best friends. And before I was on the club that kind of projected me into the future of my career as a head coach and everything, Lauren and I were pen pals on different clubs, from my club in New York to my present club now in Santa Clara. So we've been the greatest of friends for, gosh, it's going on 30 years.
Well, and I don't think any of your 20-somethings here have pen pals.
No, I don't even think people would know what a pen pal is anymore.
But that's what a great friendship.
Oh, man, yeah.
And it really speaks to the fact of how long you have wanted and pushed for the ability to compete, which, can I just be frank, most men don't have to say.
Well, you know, I've been in the sport for 35 years, but having a friend like Lauren or having the opportunity for things like that shows the support that I've received over the years. You know, like, I've never been ostracized or, you know, people have made fun of me, but it's pushed me harder. And I've always had those friends that have supported me, that have loved me, that have been my teammates, that have given me this opportunity to do what I love for so long.
I mean, you talk about it being decades long of having this goal. How old were you when you were like synchro artistic? I'm still gonna say synchro probably. That's the thing that I love. Do you remember that?
When I started synchronized swimming, because when I started it was synchronized swimming, I was 10 years old. So 35 years ago, I stepped onto that pool deck thinking, oh, this could be fun. And now 35 years later, when it's now called artistic swimming, I'm still loving it. I'm still being challenged. I'm still being supported by my coaches, my friends, my family, my club. You know, so that's what makes this journey so memorable for me, because every step along the way, it's been a challenge, but it's been a challenge for myself to make myself better rather than just saying, okay, I want to do something that no one's ever done before, because it's something that I've never done before. I've never competed in the Olympics. I've never been able to challenge myself in a way that has given me such joy that I know I'll be doing for the rest of my life.
How big a deal is it, or how significant is it, that the Olympics has opened this up, that a man can compete?
It's a huge step in the sport, because when people watch the Olympics, that's when we get the pull. That's when we get the people watching saying, I want to be an Olympian someday, or I'm inspired to go join an artistic swimming program. And I think now that men are allowed, it's only going to open the doors for more men to be in the sport, and just for more families and people around the world to say, okay, this sport is inclusive. It allows everyone. It's for families, friends, teammates, everyone all together, rather than just females.
You mentioned inclusivity, and that's really what we're talking about. There's also kind of an age inclusivity as well, which I, as somebody close to your age, really love too. I would imagine that's really exciting for people who are cheering you on too.
Well, I think it's an opportunity for our sport, for myself, and to see that, you know, like, artistic swimming is a way of life. And for any sport, the harder you train, you know, you work really hard and you set your goals, and no one's going to stand in front of your dreams, because this is something that's a personal goal for myself, but it's also something that I've always wanted to do that makes it easier. No matter if I'm 45 or 25 or 17, like some of my teammates, we all have these dreams and we all want to accomplish these dreams.
At 45, what are you doing physically to maintain just the physical part of it, but then also kind of the mental part of it too?
Well, you can see by my face with all the sunscreen, we're in the pool 8 hours a day.
Yeah.
So we're training very hard, so we have to keep our physical fitness up. And then we do cross training. I do a lot of stretching, a lot of mobility, a lot of core work. So I continue to actually develop my skill. You know, I don't think that it's ever at its peak. So I always want to get better and better and better, like all these athletes. And that's what keeps pushing us to be the greatest team that we can be.
Do you have a bit of an advantage because of life experience on the mental side?
I think I worked with Cirque du Soleil for 18 years. So I think it gives me, I don't know if it would advantage, but for myself, it gives me kind of the experience that it allows me to go out and perform and enjoy the performance rather than just thinking about the technical side.
Can you believe that the Olympics is coming up and you got a shot at going?
No, I don't. I can't believe that the Olympics are coming. And to have it right there in front of me, you know, I can taste it. I can feel the buzz with the Olympics, and I really want to be there. And it's my dream, you know. And if I make it, like, it's just going to be the cherry on top to this incredible competitive career. You know, and after the Olympics are over, I go back to my club. I'm the head coach of the Santa Clara Artistic Swimming Club, who continue to support me through all of this. So, you know, my life has developed around this sport, and I owe everything that I have to the sport of artistic swimming.
Well, and the sport owes a lot to you for continuing to fight for the opportunity.
Well, I want people to have the same opportunity that I have, the same chances, the same ability to dream. And I think that's what sport is all about.
Andrea Fuentes, thank you so much for joining us. I know you're very busy with your team, so.
Yeah, but it's always important to make our sport popular and known, so I appreciate you coming.
Oh, I'm thrilled. This is a real treat for us to be here today. Mm-hmm. Huge congratulations. For the first time since 2008, Team USA has qualified a team for the Olympics.
Yes. I'm super grateful and honored to have been helping on this mission, and I couldn't ask for a better outcome, no? And now it's like, always like not enough, and then instead of relaxing because the goal is accomplished, now we're like want to go for Olympic medal, and we can never stop wanting more, no? So now we're working hard and hard to go to the next stage of being the best athlete you can be.
Yeah, I mean, it was a big deal to get the team that recognition again.
Yeah, it was a big deal, especially because when I was a kid, I saw the US on the top, no? And slowly going down because a lot of stories and everything, and to be able to, because I was a fan, you know, of the US team when I was a kid from Spain, to be able to see how it grows and how it becomes the team that we all wanted to become, it's very rewarding. Yes,
there's so much sacrifice this year from everybody in that pool.
And especially I'm surprised because as a foreigner in from another country, and now I feel way more at home, no? But you have always the ideal that the US team has the best resources always, and not at all, no? Like, these guys have to work after practice 10 hours a day because nobody pays for their high performance center that doesn't exist. They have to find a way to pay their own apartment, their own food, which in other countries you have everything paid, like scholarships. So I was super surprised that really is like a big passion, because it's not for money, it's not for any kind of convenience, it's not a famous sport that you get recognition. So I really appreciate them doing this huge effort, and I really respect the courage to follow a passion, even if it makes like life much harder.
Yeah. One change this year is you'll have a mixed team.
Yes.
It's really different.
Very different.
How does that change the dynamic, if at all?
It changes. It changes a lot. First, because I think we're the only team left who's really trying. We have the honor to have Bill May, who has been the pioneer on making this shift since he was born. Like, thanks to him, all the boys now that have the passion for artistic swimming can do it, no? Mm-hmm. And not only this, but also, I see the media also encouraging to follow your passions, even if there's stereotypes that are not well known from the past. So I think this is a huge good step for society, and that we are the ones like helping into this direction. But at the same time, it makes it hard because we are not used to have both genders. because it's not the same mindset, no? And also, in this case, Bill has not been so much long time in the team, so it's like new addition. But at the same time, he's the person who has made this change happen for the good of the sport. So I really tried to make everything be on time, even if we had less time than others in the past. So it's difficult, but I think it's the right thing to do.
Yeah. I think, and people seem to be very excited about
it
too, which is
really... I'm sad that not every country is trying their best. It's because it's much easier to keep going as we are used to. And we are, I think, the only ones left.
So really are some trying. Countries not going to have a man on their team?
And they have world champions, for example. Italy just announced that they will not use Giorgio Minissini, which he is the world champion in solo event, male solo event. And Italy's team was 7-8. So Giorgio is the best asset they have, and they don't want to put him.
It's interesting. Yeah. So you can have a team that could be 8 women.
Yeah.
You don't have to have a man, but you can have up to 2 men.
Yes. So it's voluntary. It's not compulsory. And there's other countries. Spain has a very good athlete, and Dennis. There's Japan and China, who has very good athletes. All of them have been world champion at some point. So I'm a little bit frustrated that not everybody is trying, because it's gender equality in this sense, in not the one that we're used to, but it's also important.
Right.
Yeah.
So you have a big decision to make.
Yeah, it's a big responsibility, and I really hope we can make it work. Yeah.
So you had 12 athletes who qualified for that Olympic spot,
yeah.
But at the Olympics, only 8 can be on that mixed team.
That's like heartbreaking, because imagine, like, we have done this historic step, and 12 of us, like, all the 12 swam that time to qualify the team. Not only we qualified, but we ended up being 2nd in the world, which was like against any expectation, like much better than we thought. And now there's 4 people who have to stay home. One who can go, but only as an alternate in the case of emergency. So it's 3 people stay home. They are a very important part of the team, because they are helping every day, but we still don't know the names. But it's gonna be very, very hard to decide. Yes.
Are you committed to having a mixed team with both genders?
I really want to, but at the same time, I have to make sure that it's fair, in the sense of I have to put out the best athletes. So it's this moment of like, let's go, we can do it, but if it's gonna make the team not be in the best spot, I cannot do it, because it's not fair for all the athletes of the team. So I have to see until what point we can do it for men in the Olympics, in this sport, for society in this sense, and at what point I still have to put the best swimmers in, no? So let's see.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Big couple of months.
Yes.
Thanks for listening. You can find our podcast, Dying to Ask, The Road to Paris, wherever podcasts are found. We're hearing from athletes and experts ahead of the games.